and keep on doing what you are doing and make it funky!
This is DMC, the home of remixing. 30 years later, and DMC's still here. Change of logo up there, change of hair color up here, but DMC is still rocking.
You think you've had some treats tonight? I'm gonna give you a treat you'll tell your children about. How you doing out there tonight?
Yeah, boy!
I'd like to thank all the DJs.
Thank you, thank you.
Most definitely.
Thanks to you, it's working.
DMC!
Hi there, I'm Tony Prince of DMC. Before we embark on the history of DJ, I thought it might be important, first of all, to tell you a little bit more about DMC, our company. Today, we're in the DMC Museum. I'm surrounded by music, which is my favorite place to be. I'm passionate about the history of DJ, and it began a long time ago. There are lots of different types of DJs, but the one who I'm particularly thrilled about are the ones in the clubs who became DJ producers.
It's not a problem that I can't fix, because I can do it in the mix, in the mix.
Tell you about DMC's foundation. It began in 1983. In actual fact, it began in 1982 as a radio show on Radio Luxembourg.
From the center of the DJ world, the planet's most exclusive Saturday night show. Are you on your marks?
No!
Are you ready?
No!
Let's go!
DMC was sort of started basically as a result of a cassette that I sent to Tony Prince in the early 80s. He was working on Radio Luxembourg at the time.
Welcome! 208 on a Saturday night, Tony Prince is here to make you feel alright. It's not at 7 p.m. So don't delay, just get to radio right away. Disco makes up the place to be. You get the funky rhythm from a man so neat. So don't forget, it's on a Saturday night. He's the man who's doing it to you right.
Luxembourg. This world is all mixed up. And because of that, he started a weekly feature in his show.
I was definitely aware of DMC before. You know, I'd heard like Tony Prince's radio show on Radio Luxembourg. You know, when I was on holiday in Devon,
listening to the radio until the early hours of the morning till I fell asleep. Particularly Radio Luxembourg.
That's where the idea was founded. The idea of a club for DJs to receive mixes that were pre-produced and perfect in their rhythm. A young guy called Alan Coulthard, who did the mixes for me.
My mega mixes were one of the main features of DMC in the early days.
And later Les Adams.
He just started Disco Mix Club and he was saying on his radio show, if any DJs want to send in mixes, he'd like to hear them.
DJs went crazy for them. And so I got the idea of forming a club where you'd get a membership card, you'd get a cassette with mixes on, another cassette with previews of new tracks coming out.
Presenting the Disco Mix Club, the most exclusive club in the disco world.
The DJs of a new breed are mixing. Out in disco land, things just get better and better if your DJ is in the club. The Disco Mix Club, that is. Eventually, the cassettes became albums, which we preferred a lot more than the old-fashioned cassettes. Together with the records, the mixes, the previews, our members received a magazine. This is the world's first mix mag, and it was published at the same time as the club was founded, in February 1983, with the very first mix, Shalimar. After that, Kool and the Gang, Michael Jackson, Earth, Wind and Fire, we had a lot of fun.
Tony was running the business from converted stables in the back of his house. All very nice,
In those days, DJs couldn't mix themselves.
And we taught DJs what they could become, producers. DMC flourished, and within a year, we had branches around the world, and DJs from around the world sending in their own mixes. And it all just blew up from there, the whole DJ culture. Now, I know the old school DJs watching this will know that story because they're a part of that story, as are all the superstar DJs who are heralded around the world these days. They were there at the start when we made that move from a chatting, talking DJ in a nightclub to a guy who makes his own music. So after 30 years, we decided it was time for DMC to invite a lot of those old friends to a party, record pluggers, DJs, all the people who helped us to make DMC what it became, a fabulous DJ-only music-making club. We threw a party at the Hippodrome. Now, this venue was where we started DMC's conventions 30 years previously. It's a casino now, and it was a great environment for this party. So, come along, let's see what all our friends have got to say. We'll take the camera with us.
DMC had been around, they brought over James Brown, which to me was one of the highlights of this British company.
Who is the greatest artist in the world? And there were many like-minded souls in the music industry who helped DMC to succeed.
I think, like, back then, I thought it was going to be like another punk, another neuromantic. It was going to be like 5 years max we could stretch out of it.
Yeah.
30 years later.
Amazing. Incredible. It is incredible.
Here we all are with almost the entire dance music record industry of the late 80s, early 90s. And it's exhausting. It's exhausting. Yeah, it really is.
Us three.
I mean, the people downstairs.
Our guests at the Hippodrome included many record promotion men and women whose passion for dance music, combined with DMC's power to promote their music, led to a seismic change around the DJ world.
Funny thing is, we are sitting in a room now at the very top of the Hippodrome, the legendary Hippodrome, and I can always remember the only time I could ever come here was when there was DMC parties on, because it was the only way I could get it for nothing, otherwise I'd probably try and make it pay. What DMC did was they managed to pull together all these DJs, because it wasn't a career option then.
I've got this to say before we do anything next, right? It's about 99% DJs in here tonight. Now, up until a few years ago, people didn't used to think a great deal about disc jockeys.
What? You want to be a DJ? What do you need a DJ for? Join the army. No, I want to be a DJ.
They used to treat DJs like the glass collectors, right? All that has changed now, and we've proved that if you are a DJ, you can become somebody very upfront. You can put records in the charts, and you can show the whole fucking country that you are one of the most important people in a big industry.
They pulled together a load of people and made it into a club and a family. One thing about DMC is it's a family, and it still is. It's so lovely to be here tonight and see all these people that I've known for 20, 30 years, and they're so welcoming. It's so lovely, honestly. It makes me feel good.
Top of our guest list were the original DJs who became inspirational producers for their colleagues and members of DMC.
I was working in Le Beat Route, which was quite a famous club, actually not far from here, to be honest, in the West End, in the new romantic era, when Spandau Ballet and Duran Duran were all big at the time. So that was really my only sort of live work, to be honest. And I did used to play my mixes there in sort of early 80s, 81, 82. And then that led to the cassette that I sent to Tony in, I think it was early 82.
I can remember listening on the radio when I was very, very young, and hearing the early mixes from Alan Coulthard, and being very inspired to be a DJ. When we came out with these Michael Jackson mixes from Alan Coulthard and all these wonderful Shalabar mixes, it was a time which was really special for the DJ.
A guy came in one night, and his name was Greg James. Now, he turned out to be the understudy of the very famous DJ Richie Kazor, who was the resident DJ at Studio 54 in New York. And he was a legendary mixer. This guy had been taught by him. And Greg came up to the DJ box one night and said, you know, just want to introduce myself. My name's Greg, you may not know who I am. At the time he was DJing at the Embassy in London. And he said, the music you're playing is fantastic, but your mixing's rubbish. And so I resisted the temptation to punch him in the mouth. I was intrigued and I said, well, okay, what can you do better? And he came into the DJ box and played for 15 minutes and just absolutely blew me away. I said, can you teach me how to do that? And Greg and I became good friends. So I was taught by the understudy of Richie Kazor. So it was a very good training ground because he really knew his stuff and he taught me about how to kick count beats and bars, taught me about key clashes, about synchronizing in bars, not just beats, not just getting boom, boom, boom on top of the other, but they've all got to make sense. He taught me that music is a language and if you don't understand the language, you can't speak it. You have to learn how it's structured and that's really the start of it all.
To me and said, can I play 10 minutes? I said, no. He said, why? I said, okay. So we let him go on stage, completely unrehearsed. And what he did was he introduced a sample into Club Land. We'd never seen it before. And he mixed Human League, Don't You Want Me, Baby. And 1,000 DJs at the DMC 85 convention left this building, converted, knowing the day had ended where they could hope to get away with talking after every record. It was time for the DJ to become a producer, and this man is the man who inspired the world. Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Sammy X!
Sammy's Tina Charles' I Love to Love became the first charted for a DJ producer.
Remixing really wasn't even heard of in this country until DMC came along. Of DJ becoming a producer and an artist, the whole DJ culture stemmed from DMC really.
Yeah, it didn't exist.
Yeah, they were responsible for that and, you know, obviously we're all still here all this time later and as you said, we owe them a lot for that.
I joined the company of DMC way, way back in 1985. And I was just a DJ, and I used to get these tapes through the post. Any younger people who are looking at this, you wouldn't know what tapes are, but they were cassettes, and that was how we played our music. And in those days, I actually used to mime to DMC. This, I shouldn't really say this, but I used to put a DMC cassette on, and I used to mime to it in my clubs, and the crowd would go crazy. And that's when I thought, I've got to be a member of DMC. I was there for about 6 months, and then I got the wonderful opportunity to come and work down south with Christine and Tony Prince.
We're way ahead of America on DJ mixing. They're lagging way behind us, I have to say it. Because I've been there, I've been all around the world seeing mixing as it, in the state of the art as it stands at the moment. And the British guys in particular are way, way ahead of everyone else.
What it took in America for it to cross over into the clubland and the DJ culture to actually start to penetrate were actually the Brits, which is the most hilarious thing, that it took British DJs to bring the DJ culture to America.
A lot of European guys catching up very quickly. Holland's very strong, you know. British guys, and talking about mixing, not just live mixing, producing their own remixes. DJs are buying such sophisticated equipment now, and it's the British DJs who are leading the world on that as well, you know. The Americans are way behind us on this one for a change.
For some reason, England, as small as a country as it is, I don't know what it is that they put in the water, but you know, whether it's dance, whether it's rock, whether it's whatever you want to call it, you know, it's all spawned from there, and I don't get it, but you guys, I don't know if it's the drinking all the time, going to the pubs, maybe that's what it is. Maybe everybody in America needs to start going to the pub at 5 o'clock in the afternoon.
Yeah, and it was also about chances. I mean, you know, Dave won his position at DMC in a competition. I got
in a raffle.
I didn't know. Yeah. He won it.
I never even entered the raffle.
Yeah, no. And then like 2 years later, he's editing this. I got given a job just because I hassled the guy called Paul Decanus downstairs, who's still one of my heroes. I hassled him so much that he had to give me a job just to like make him tea. And I left quite a good job to go there. And then I was sleeping on the studio floor and everything. So because of them, that we all got given a shot. And we didn't know what we were doing. They just put us in the studio and let us get on with it.
And so many people have become superstars because of that, including Oki, Dave Seaman, Steve Anderson, it was all because of that DMC chance that they got.
As a teenager in 1979, I went to see an American DJ called Danny Pucciarelli play at a club in Leeds called The Warehouse. And at that time, I'd been to a few clubs, but you know, my local town wasn't doing it for me. And we trotted off to Leeds, where this American DJ was doing this crazy stuff with disco music, and we wanted to check it out. So I saw this guy mixing music, blending from one to another, to another, to another. And it was like this epiphany, this magic moment, which just completely got me and transformed the rest of my life.
Next time on the History of DJ, we continue part two of the story of DMC. Off we go to New York's New Music Seminar.
Hello, New York. We're back here again.
Where so much DJ culture developed.
I met Tony Prince there, and he invited me to come over to be involved in his competition, which was DMC.
And then to the Royal Albert Hall, with the most amazing artists we could ever have hoped to grace our stage.
You don't get photographs like this at the BPI Awards.